Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Good day to you, my friend. Welcome to the broadcast. Thank you so much for joining us and allowing us to be part of your day. Right now, my Bible is sitting open to the book of Ruth, that little story of those wonderful ladies there in the Old Testament, Ruth and chapter 2. If you can, reach over and pick up your own copy of the Word of God. Join me in Ruth chapter 2. I'll begin to read at verse 8 here in a moment. You may also want to get a piece of paper on which you can jot some notes. We will be giving our outline for a paragraph here as we continue our verse-by-verse study in the book of Ruth. I also have a gospel tract here. This one's entitled, How Can a Person Be Away? I hesitate to say this, but probably this is my one most favorite track. I think it most clearly lays out the gospel. I love all of our tracks that we produce, and I want to put a sample packet containing one each of all of our tracks in your hand, but please, you got to get this one. How Can a Person Be Away? I'll say more about that track here in just a minute. Well, let me ask a question. How good are you and I at taking God at His word? If you have been part of a solid Bible preaching church for very long, then you have been challenged to know God's word and then to act like the word of God is true. Now, we've all been challenged to believe that God means just what He says in His word. But almost every born-again person has had their struggles and doubts about their salvation, especially in the early years of their Christian life. These doubts usually come after we've really sinned in a big way, or we spend some time thinking about just how sinful we were before we got saved. Virtually all of us have heard an inner voice say something like this: "You can't really be saved. A real Christian would never have done that sin." Or we've heard something like this in our head: "Well, how could God really love you and want you as His child in light of the depth of your sin before you got saved?" Well, here in Ruth chapter 2, Ruth is going to be told something that she's just going to struggle to believe. But after these words of kindness and grace are repeated, Ruth's going to end up resting in their truthfulness. That's the application we're going to be able to make from the passage today. But first, let's look at the actual story and the struggle in Ruth's life. Get your Bible open to Ruth chapter 2. I mentioned that gospel tract a moment ago. Again, its title is, How Can a Person Be Away? And the reason I think this gospel tract is so effective, and by the way, it's effective in every culture, whether that culture is here in the United States, or it's in a Muslim culture, or it's in a Buddhist culture, or in a Hindu culture, or in a culture like in South America, you name it, this tract works because of the clarity of the illustration. It begins with a story of a person in a burning building on the fifth floor. There's no way out. There's no hope. But then all of a sudden, come bursting through the window is a fireman who is fully prepared to save them. And he says, "You got to come with me." And it lays out the truth that salvation is in a person. That person in the burning building has to trust the fireman. The fireman is prepared, is qualified to get them to safety. And we go from there to go and to explain that Christ is qualified and prepared to take you from sin, death, and hell to the safety of God's grace, mercy, and forgiveness, and glory in heaven. Oh, friend, here's a great gospel tract. How Can a Person Be Away? It's probably my favorite tract of all the ones we produce here. Would you please let me send it to you along with that sample packet? At the end of the program, my announcer will make known to you three ways by which you can get a hold of us and giving us your name and mailing address. Have that pen and paper ready so you can jot a way down to call us, write us, whatever. You can go to our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Well, if your Bible's open there to the book of Ruth, chapter 2, beginning at verse 8, here is what the story of Ruth, how it continues. It says, "Then said Boaz unto Ruth, Hearest thou not, my daughter? Go not to glean in another field, neither go from thence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go to the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn." Then she fell on her face and bowed herself to the ground and said unto him, "Why have I found grace in thine eyes, that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger?" And Boaz answered and said unto her, "It hath fully been showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knowest not heretofore, and the Lord recompense thy work, and full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust." Then she said, "Let me find favor in thine eyes, O Lord, for that thou hast comforted me, and for that thou hast spoken friendly unto thine handmaiden, though I be not like unto one of thy handmaidens." Stop, please, right there. These verses, verses 8 to 13, are the second paragraph in the chapter. My title for paragraph number 1, verses 1 through 7, was The Work. Notice the W word, the work. Now, in those verses, Ruth goes to work in a field, and her goal was simply to meet the physical needs of herself and her mother-in-law. God, though, uses that work to bring her into contact and the notice of Boaz, the man who will soon become her husband. My alternative title for verses 1 through 7 was The Introduction, because there Ruth and Boaz are introduced. But now we come to paragraph number 2, and now we're allowed to see the first words spoken between Ruth and Boaz, and that's really my title for the paragraph, The Words. Paragraph 1, The Work, now The Words. My alternate title here is The Interest, because here it is obvious that Boaz is taking a personal interest in Ruth's life. Now, I really can't say that there's any heart passion between them at this point, but here is what I do see. Four things. Number 1, I see righteous words. Remember, my title for this paragraph is The Words. I see righteous words in verses 8 and 9. After Boaz hears his field foreman's report on Ruth's activity in verses 6 and 7, Boaz comes to her aid. Boaz takes it upon himself to do three things. He gives her a place to work. Well, actually, she gets quite adamant that she is not supposed to go and work in anybody else's field. But then Boaz gives her protection in verse 9. He is given strict orders that Ruth not be harmed. And finally, he gives her provision. Boaz tells her to use the same food and the same water which he provides for his own workers. The second thing I see here in the paragraph are responding words. First, righteous words, now responding words here in verse 10. Ruth is taken back by the kindness of Boaz. In verse 10, she asks him, "Why in the world is he showing her such grace?" She reminds Boaz she's a stranger, she's a non-Jew. He has no responsibility to be gracious to her. That brings us to the third thing I see. I see rewarding words in verses 11 and 12. If you're taking notes, there were the righteous words, the responding words, and now rewarding words. In verses 11 and 12, we find the blessing and grace by Boaz onto Ruth are all based upon a life decision she made. She decided to leave Moab and come to Israel to care for her mother-in-law. Boaz itemizes three things about Ruth's decision. In verse 11, Boaz talks about Ruth's tenderness to Naomi. Next, in verse 11, he speaks about her turning. She is turned away from her old natural family, her old natural kingdom, and she is turned to a new family and a new kingdom. Now, please forgive my passion as an evangelist here, but what I've just described sure sounds like old 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10 to me. When a person receives Christ, they turn to God away from idols. They are transferred from the kingdom of darkness, according to Colossians 1:13, into the kingdom of God's own Son. That's the turning I find here. The fourth thing I see here are resting words in verse 13. Resting words. I love what Ruth says here. She says, "Boaz, you have spoken to me with friendly words. You have not talked to me like I'm a Moabite, a Gentile woman. You've talked to me as if I am a Jewish woman." In verse 10, she struggled to believe what Boaz was saying. She struggled to hear all the blessing he was bestowing on her. She struggled to believe all the grace that he was showing her. But now in verse 13, now she comes and she has heard his explanation. She has heard more of his words. And now she finds rest in what he has said. She believes that all he has said is true for herself. Oh, my friend, if you have ever doubted what God says about you, if you've ever doubted about God's grace and forgiveness in your life, do what Ruth has done. Ask him, ask God, why has he been so gracious to you? That's where Ruth does. She goes and says, "Boaz, why are you talking to me this way? Why are you saying all these gracious words?" Dear struggling saint listening to the broadcast, go to God, ask him, "Why, God, are you talking so gracious to me?" Then open the Bible, read his word, listen to his voice again. That's what Ruth does. She gets a second dose of Boaz's voice. Get another dose of the voice of your heavenly Father from his word. Read places like Ephesians 1 and 2. Read in Colossians chapters 1 and 2. These places there, you're going to hear his words. You're going to hear his voice. You're going to find greater rest as you hear his voice say his truth again. Oh, friend, we're saved by hearing the truth. We're made solid in our life and our walk with God by hearing it and becoming more appreciative and more trusting of the truth God has said. If you're listening to me today without your salvation issue dealt with, here's what God says to you out of his truth. Yes, you are a sinner. Yes, you deserve hell. But God says, "I love you, and I have made a way of escape from hellfire through my own Son. He died on the cross, shed his blood. Receive him as your Savior. Do it now, and I will forgive all and give you eternal life." Do that, my friend. If you've just decided to receive Christ as Savior, contact us, please.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888, and our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.